right now. A spokesman from Capitol Records, Canada, has just stepped out on stage to announce the release of David Bowie's brand new LP, Never Let Me Down, on the 20th of April. And very soon, David Bowie will be taking the stage. This was announced somewhat impromptu, very short notice. We were told there was a press conference coming up, and asked to attend and perhaps to ask a few questions. We arrived to see a band set up on stage, and the word that David Bowie will be performing somewhere between... There he is now, David Bowie on stage at the Diamond Club in Toronto.
Still going here?
Still going?
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning. I'd like to introduce you to the guys working with me. On keyboards over there, well lit, is Richard Cottle from England. On drums behind me, Alan Childs. On bass, Carmine Rojas. On guitar, ever-loving Carlos Alomar. And I'm very honored to have on lead guitar, Peter Frampton.
Oh, we're so banned and we're going out this year. It's just like us. You better off.
And I presume you gentlemen are from the press. No?
Oh.
We're in the wrong place. Hello over there, you're not, are you? No. Would anybody like to ask anything? We've got 40 seconds. Hey, that's nice, thank you very much. I'm very well, how are you? Happy St. Patrick's Day. No, I'm not. I saw him in LA and I saw him in New York and he looks great. Is that on the pretend? That's a great band. Kevin Armstrong's really good. Is that there with the Pretenders or is he on his own? Yeah. I'm sorry, am I going to be... I'm not working with Iggy on his tour, no. I've got my own tour to do. But I've been catching up with him and we'll probably end up going to see each other. I worked with Iggy on his album last year, the early part of last year, and we tried writing together constantly before we went into the studio, because often I've got a habit of writing in the studio, but this time sort of worked it out before. And it became a very energetic sound for Jim, and the way that we worked was just with the minimal amount of musicians. And it worked great for him, so I tried the same system for me. And I wrote most of the stuff before I went in. And I went into the studio with Carlos, a Turkish friend of mine called Erdal Kızılki, who's a multi-instrumentalist, and Peter, basically. And we put the thing together on our own, and just added people, Carmine, whatever. And I guess it was written for stage more than anything else, so it's a very high-energy album. It's 11 tracks. I did them all except for one. Well, I did one with Carlos. I'm sorry, Carlos. And the 11th track is an Iggy track. Some bands do Stone, some bands do Chuck Berry. I cover Iggy Pop. Yeah, it's on you. You'll hear it.
David, this is
What do I think, Toronto? Been here for, well, for the times that I've been here before, we've had a great time. So, I know it will never let me down.
Oh,
I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry, love. Yeah, go on, have another go.
Are you
going to do any
more movies, or
will you be? Yeah, nothing, obviously, for this year. I mean, right through to the December, we'll be working on the road. But next year, I hope to... I've got a couple of things that I'd like to kind of work out myself, produce, and possibly attempt a direction next year. So I'm more interested, I think, in directing something.
Somebody better ask than, about videos.
Necessarily acting.
Where people get in there.
David, this is a unique way of...
There's an English movie. Well, it's an animated movie. It's a catastrophe movie about the release of a nuclear bomb. It's called When the Wind Blows. Well, I don't think it's out over here yet, is it? That I did the title song for. That should be released over here in a few months, I think. It's a stunning story about an elderly couple who try and survive through the use of the government handbook on how to survive a nuclear fallout, which means like putting wooden doors up against walls and bringing in pints of water and stuff like that. It's a very tragic, sad little movie, but it was a good piece to work on. Yeah. The tour starts in end of May. The first, here we go, first date is Rotterdam. First date is Rotterdam. I think for full listings of those kinds of things, Michael could probably help out, frankly, a lot better than I can. I mean, like, you know, we've done a lot of citizenship. You know. Anyway, where there's this stage, it's a world tour, yeah. Yeah, we're playing North America's, and they're playing Europe, England. We really want me to start England, Germany, France, Spain, Italy, Scandinavia, Australia, Japan, New Zealand, Akron. We're a complete band. This is it. There's only one person missing from our band at the moment because he's working in, I believe he's in Italy working, that's Erdal Kazilki, who is my Turkish pal, who's sort of, he grew up in a Turkish village, so he had nothing better to do than play music. So he went to the equivalent of a Turkish Juilliard, and so he learned to play every single instrument in the orchestra, and he had a natural orientation to funk, and so everything, so he plays funky violin, funky harp, stuff like that. Yeah. I'm sorry. I haven't done a very theatrical tour in a long time, so I think you should expect something quite extraordinarily theatrical this time. On the other hand, I'm trying to incorporate a lot of theatre ideas that I've had in the past. Last time I went out, the whole thing built up so out of proportion that I thought it best that I just more or less present myself as a singer-songwriter, which was a big new audience for me, and I didn't want to confuse people as to what I do. But this time around, hopefully they'll understand that I do write songs and sing them. And this time I can add to it a little. And hey man, it's way over the top. It's a big show. You know, I was thinking about that. It's really hard. It certainly wasn't a context in mind when I wrote it. I think the only thing that was predominant in my mind is that I knew I was going on the road with it. And so it was, it hopefully had some kind of energy built into it. The subject matter does deal a lot with the streets. There's a certain amount of attitudes towards an uncaring society. I think maybe that might be a predominant feature. Otherwise, in style, I seem to have delved in... you probably know that I'm pretty eclectic as a writer, and I've always been a huge rock fan, and I think there's an awful lot of influences on the album from other singers, from Smokey Robinson, Prince, Lennon, Dylan, Screaming Blue Messiahs. Who are my favourite band at the moment, by the way? Big plug there. Nobody else won? Nobody plays them? That's you play them. Good man. Gun Shy is a great album. Great. And Bubba. I like that. I did a video with Julian Temple just the other week in Los Angeles. the people that we worked in with it, again, it's a street video, but we, as you probably know, there's an incredible homeless situation going on in not only in Los Angeles, but it's certainly being highlighted there. And we hired a lot of homeless people that were on the streets in East LA. The amazing thing is that these guys have formed themselves into a theatre group and were doing plays based around what it's like to be homeless on the streets of LA. So, and they work with us as actors and extras, and they were just fantastic. So everybody, the casting of the video are real people in real situations, and I wouldn't go as far as to say it's an indictment, but it's I believe it's quite strong meat as far as videos go, because I never try and just do a I don't often do glam videos. I try not to just do. I try and make some fundamental statement, either about an artistic statement or a social statement, or try and use video in a certain way. It's not just sort of. I don't do very many just performance videos. I think it's very successful, but who knows? With me, this last 2 years, absolutely nothing. Last year. The question, if you didn't hear it, was what's the relationship between what I'm doing in movies and music, yeah? Time ratio. This last year, 86, was writing the whole year with Jimmy and myself, and then recording with Jimmy and Iggy, Jimmy, you know what I mean. Jimmy Osterberg, ha! Iggy Pop. So it was all writing last year, and this year has just been all performance and just trying to work the show out that I want to do this year. Just a minute, can I just want to... I'm sorry? Well, it was our day off, and we thought it's the nicest place we could come to on a Thursday. Do you want to answer that one, Peter?
Yeah, well...
I'm terribly sorry. You know, you really... I mean, Peter and Carlos and anybody else in the band, if you've got questions for them, please, you know.
Well, I was touring last...
Don't answer that.
Oh, okay. I was touring last summer, I believe. Remember, I was up here with the Stevie Nicks tour. And David called me, and while I was at the hotel... It was probably here, actually. Called me and asked me if I'd like to play on the album, which I was thrilled about, obviously. And then through the course of the album, Dave and I started talking about the possibility of working together on the road, which was terrific for me, because to be just a guitarist in the band and work with David is great.
Can I say
something?
Yeah, welcome back, Peter. Can I say something really corny there, Peter?
All right.
Should we? You might not know that Peter and I actually used to go to school together. Do you want a better one than that? His father was my art master. Which doesn't say a lot for your dad, Pete. You haven't seen my paintings. Maybe just leave that for a minute. I'm sorry. This one, naturally. Which has been my most satisfying experience with albums? You know, obviously one always says it as an artist, but one feels it is credible and genuine that the latest piece of work represents and is the most exciting project that one is involved with. However, looking back, I would say for me the trilogy of albums that I did with Brian Eno, that was the most satisfying. Yeah. Running out, but Spin Magazine says I'm running out of personas. What do you think? No, man. Who said that? That's reactionary. You're on the question. What do you think about it? Thank you. Well, for him, it's not a new school anymore. He's been there a few years. I don't know, that died out about 15 years ago. It's a co-ed, you know. I mean, to expand on that, what he's learning is how to climb mountains, sail boats, and work computers. So that's, you know, it's an all-rounded kind of thing. Thank you for asking.
Very nice.
There might be some what influences? There inevitably will be theatrically, yeah. I mean, that was the form of theatre, Brechtian Expressionist theatre. I think, actually, the Brechtian part I don't understand, because the Brechtian theatre was all about alienating the audience from preventing them becoming too subjective. But of course in rock and roll, the whole idea is to be subjective. It's a part of an overwhelming feeling of subjectivity. But in terms of expressionist theatre, I think it's expressionist artists were known to paint literally with their hearts on their sleeves. It was very top level, not superficial, but very apparent and very obvious what they were trying to say. And I think rock and roll is a naive and obvious way of stating forms. And it's a living culture, and I think for me expressionism is a living culture. For me too, so the two go together quite well. The Brechtian part, I like the lighting. I saw Les Misérables. Very long. It's a stunning piece of work, but it's incredibly long to sit through. I saw it in London, but it's good. Sure. A movie project with Jagger. That's a good idea. It's in the air. I haven't had one for many years. On the last tour, the last time I worked with somebody was on the Diamond Dogs tour with Tony Basil. And on this one, I'll be working with Tony Basil. It's the first time we've worked together since 74. What am I thinking of pop music in general? Have you got 3.5 hours? I find a lot of radio, specifically, I can't say I know about Canadian radio because I've not had it long enough to listen here, but in American radio, it's very strong on format, so I think it's very hard for is it the same here? It's very hard for unique or new-sounding bands to break through, probably the reason why Screaming Blues probably have a tough job. That's got to change because there's a lot of extraordinary bands happening now in the fringe and in the underground again. And it's so cyclic. There's always a new current of new bands that are exciting and make it all worthwhile. I'm sorry, sir, I can't hear you. I tell you what I do like is the... All right. I'm a bit ambiguous about this, but I like very much Run DMC, and the idea of what Beastie Boys are doing in terms that... I don't like the violence attached to the gigs. I think that's very frightening, but it's very sort of Kubrickian, Clockwork Orangey kind of thing. But the fact that they're pulling the focus and the attention back to stage as opposed to video all the time, I think is a very healthy thing. And they're making the idea of concert and stage and audience participation something valid again, which I think is very healthy.
Healthy.
Ridiculous word.
Yeah.
In cinema? The star of the cinema for me at the moment is, well, two. David Lynch, I think, is tremendous. And Alex Cox, well, I think, is just great as well. And, of course, you know, Scorsese and all that. Gee, I'm real sorry, man. It's real hard for me to hear you.
Project ball, please.
Yeah. Well, for me, I started off being a guitarist, and Humble Pie was a very enjoyable time for me. And I think basically that I'm looking forward to this because I am going to be able to play more guitar than anything else and leave the fronting to David, which that's my main love, is to play guitar.
I think that's, if I can come back to that, it wasn't... Tell me if I'm out of line, Peter, but that's something that kind of got lost some time ago, is the fact that you are primarily started off as one of England's top guitarists. And how things happen, the media change things, and it kind of got shadowed, the fact that Peter is a brilliant guitarist, and you wait and see this tour, mate.
The picture sort of started off down here, and then the guitar was just a picture of my face, so they forgot about the guitar.
Ended up on the shoes.
You wouldn't happen to be a Canadian DJ by any chance? That hadn't occurred to me. I'll give it much thought. Well, funny question. How did I meet Carlos? Correct me if I'm wrong, wasn't it that night at the Apollo?
No, Carlos, no, we met back in 1973 before the Young Americans tour when David was producing Lulu at the time, and I was working with RCA as a house musician. I was working with The Main Ingredient. Then we got together for doing Lulu's album, and that worked out very well, so we continued until now. Yeah, I have an album out now on Private Music. It's called Dream Generator. And what I've done is I've gone somewhat back to the old Heroes, the trilogy kind of thing. It's for a quote-unquote New Age music company. So I've kind of gone back, you know, to the original, to what we call the original New Age music, and tag that. And I have a new album out now, yeah.
You're plugging your album. I love it.
You mean?
It's a great album, by the way, Dream Generator. Yes, sir. I'm terribly sorry. You must just hit them harder, will you?
What a question. That's an amazing question.
Did you get the question, man? Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, it was David Jones, and then the other lot came up. I tell you, all right, I'll follow that one up. Before then, I had one week where I was Tom Jones. Do you believe that?
That was good.
I've still got the photographs to prove it. Yeah. Ooh. Mm. When I was about 11, when I was about 10 or 11, I bought, amongst a bunch of records, a Little Richard record. And I think that really was the starting point for me. When I heard that sax line up and the piano and the pure funk of Lucille, I think that really just I just didn't want to do anything. I'd see the next door neighbor, Mrs. Norris, passing along the street with a bottle of milk, and I thought, I've got to get out of here. Moved by the death of Andy Warhol. I think any death is sad. I wasn't particularly close with him, but it's, I appreciate that it was the end of an era, yeah. I think the whole entire creative process is a struggle and very painful indeed. I don't think an artist can never reveal too much. Competition with what? Absolutely no sense of competition whatsoever. What with my 83 tour? No way, different animals. The thing is, when I do a tour, I don't then go out the next year and the next year and the next year. I only tour when I really, really want to tour. At the end of the 83 tour, like every tour I've ever done, I'll say, I'll never do that again. My God, I'm worn out. I could never. The next year, you think, oh, that was a lot of fun. It really was silly. Then the third year, you think, oh, I can't wait to get out there. And the fourth year, you're just writing like crazy and you're just drawing sets and, you know. And that's the way to do it for me. I couldn't just go out year after year. So it's not a competition. It's like, wow, let's try and do that again, but different and a different angle and better and incorporate more ideas. Hard to give up Ziggy. You a historian. Hard to give up Ziggy. I think I can't even think about that anymore. That is a long time ago. Listen, I'll take three more questions, if I may. I've heard Bauhaus doing Ziggy Stardust, so I didn't like that at all. The Frankie one, do you know Frankie? I haven't heard it. I don't know the Frankie one. Yeah? We planned on doing it in a few cities, yeah. Yes, I have. I think it's tremendous. It's amazing. It's going to be a movie. Not mine, unfortunately, but it is going to be a movie. One more question. That. That man there. Did you just ask that? No, you didn't. All right. That lady. Sets, costumes, makeup, floss, everything. The lot. The full works. I didn't work with Jim on this one, no. That's it. Thank you very much indeed. It's a new song from the album.
It's just a fun of a secret. A lot of secrets in the UK. Torn apart in the UK. The dribble of me day 87 and cry 87 and cry. And there's nothing in mind. And there's nothing inside. Oh, and only you rocket on through the sky. But it couldn't be done without dogs. No, it couldn't be once without 87 and cry. 87. When the days were the days, boys. When blue ties were by the big guys.
Trinity was sent down by the enemy.
You'd never guess they were the enemy. And there's nothing in love. And there's no way to scream.
We'll see you on tour. Thanks for being so nice. Bye-bye.
of that particular song. It's a new one from his latest LP, Due on the Streets, on April the 20th. The album's called Never Let Me Down. The very first song before the press conference was called Day In and Day Out. That apparently will be the first single. So there you have it, the David Bowie press conference. Now, is that the way to have a press conference or what? Live at the Diamond Club with his band, many of whom performed on the record, and apparently all of whom will be going on the road with him. Okay, now we're going to go back to the studios. And, yes, I can carry on and talk. Well, I just want to tell you that it was pretty exciting being here, and I'm really glad that you could come with us. And David Bowie, live at the Diamond Club. Two songs, the album again is called Never Let Me Down. We're going to go back to the studio for Look Back in Anger. Here's David Bowie on Much Music.